Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, brothers and sisters. Welcome back to another lesson on the origins and the evolution of the Hanafi Madhhab. Today, alhamdulillah, we're going to be looking at the life of Imam Muhammad bin Hasan al-Shaybani rahimahullah, another great student of Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi, and one of the foundational scholars of the Hanafi Madhhab. Now you recall in the last lesson we went over the life of Abu Yusuf rahmatullahi alayhi. We had begun going into the post Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi era. We went over how Imam Abu Yusuf rahmatullahi alayhi was designated a chief justice under the Abbasi governance, and he served under three different governors, three different khalifas. And he used that platform to spread the knowledge of his ustad, Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi, with the vision that the teachings of his ustad do not be limited to the borders of Kufa, but they be spread far and wide. We saw that how he would designate judges in different regions that were following the same methodology. He also prepared a couple of students to go back into their hometowns and to begin teaching the fiqh of Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi. So in essence, what Abu Yusuf rahmatullahi alayhi was doing was he had dug the foundations of the madhab as we know it today. So as he had now dug the foundations of the madhab, Imam Muhammad bin Hasan al-Shaybani rahmatullahi alayhi is the one that poured cement into those foundations. And thus the foundation was now prepared for a structure to stand on it. Now how did Imam Muhammad bin Hasan al-Shaybani rahmatullahi alayhi pour cement in these foundations? Through the literature that he had prepared, and he spread far and wide. Now, before we do go into those books, it's important for us to be somewhat acquainted with Imam Muhammad bin Hasan al-Shaybani rahimahullah. This is that scholar who had taken up his studies in fiqh as a teenager under Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi until the age of 18, because that's when Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi passed away. And then he continued his studies under Abu Yusuf, completed it with him. Then he traveled to Madinatul Munawwara. There he became the student of Imam Malik bin Anas rahimahullah, acquired 700 ahadith from him, also is one of the writers of the Muatta, and he basically came back and devoted a lot of his time to literature, to preparing different books, which for the era was a complete game changer. Today what I want to do, inshallah, is give you an introduction to some of those books so that you become acquainted with the type of work Imam Muhammad bin Hasan al-Shaybani rahmatullahi alayhi had done and how it contributed to the formation of the Hanafi Madhab as we know it today. So inshallah, I'd like you to come with me, join me inshallah, and let me take you on a little tour of his books. Come with me. So here we have some of the books of Imam Muhammad bin Hasan al-Shaybani rahimahullah, which I'm going to share with you inshallah. We're going to go through all of these books, and I'm just going to give you a bit of orientation on them inshallah. So here's the first book. This book is Kitab al-Asl. This book is pretty much the foundation of the madhab, right? All the main principles and the foundational regulations of the madhab have been compiled in this book here. Now, the copy that I have, it spans around 12 volumes. This book was actually a collection of books that Imam Muhammad bin Hasan al-Shaybani rahmatullahi alayhi had written. So upon his passing, it's the students of Imam Muhammad that had prepared this compendium, and it's known as Al-Asl, as you can see here. And some people even call it Al-Mabsut. It goes by two names. The copy that we hear has gone by the name of Al-Asl. And in this book, what you find is Imam Muhammad rahmatullahi alayhi has compiled the rulings of his ustad, Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi, either in a conversational manner, which he's doing a Q&A with his ustad, and he's recording that dialogue, or what he's doing is he's just going ahead and writing down the regulations. Doesn't really get into the evidences because that wasn't the style of the time. And he also supplements his book with a few of the regulations that have been devised by Abu Yusuf rahmatullahi alayhi, and definitely he's going to put forth his own opinion. So let's give you a little example. Okay, so say for example here, you look at the chapter of Tayammum. Okay, Babu Tayammum bi Sa'idi. So this is to perform Tayammum with any earthly substance that is found on the surface of the earth. We call it Sa'id. So look at this portion here. You see that where it says Qultu. Okay, so we see here Qultu. That's Imam Muhammad bin Hassan al-Shaybani rahmatullahi speaking. He said, I asked. And he goes, Ara'ayta musafiran. So now he's addressing Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi. Ara'ayta musafiran tayammama fi awwal al-waqt wa salla wa lam yantadhir ila akhir al-waqt thumma wajada al-ma'a ba'da faraghihi min as-sala wa ba'da ma sallama. So he's asking, what is your view on a traveler that has performed tayammum in the beginning time of a prayer? He performed his prayer and he did not wait until the end time. And then after that, he found water after completing his prayer and after he had gone and said salam. So basically the question that he's posing here is that, is this going to have any impact on the salah that he has just performed? So Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi, he's answering, qala salatuhu tamma. Okay, his prayer is complete. Look at that, salatuhu tamma. That's Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi's words right there. Okay, his prayer is valid, his prayer is complete. So Imam Muhammad is now going to ask a counter question. Qultu, ara'ayta in wajad al-ma'a qabla an yusallima. What is your view if he had found water before he said salam in the prayer that he was performing? وَقَدْ قَعَدَ قَدْرَ التَّشَهُدِ أَوْ وَجَدَ الْمَاءَ قَبْلَ أَنْ يَقْعُدَ قَدْرَ التَّشَهُدِ. And so he's saying that he had already sat for the duration of saying the tashahud, or found water before he even sat for the duration of the tashahud. So Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi is now going and giving his fatwa, as you can see here. قَالْ صَلَاتُهُ فَاسِدَ. His salah is invalid. So what I wanted to demonstrate here is how he's going ahead and he's sharing with us the dialogue that he had with his ustad and how he's recorded it, as you can see here. Now, if we go to the next page, we're going to find that he continues by saying that وَيَتَوَضَّأُ وَيَسْتَقْبِلُ الصَّلَاةَ فِي قَوْلِ أَبِي حَنِيفَةَ. So what this individual is going to be required to do is he's going to go and perform his wudu. He has to redo his salah according to Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi's view. Now, remember when I said that he's also going to supplement it with the views of Abu Yusuf? So here's the example of that. وَأَمَّا فِي قَوْلِ أَبِي يُوسُفَ. That as for the view of Abu Yusuf and Muhammad. So he's making reference to him as, he's making reference to himself as a third party, a third person. So he, according to the view of Abu Yusuf and Muhammad, that's himself, فَصَلَاتُهُ تَامَّ. His prayer is complete. إِذَا كَانَ قَدْ قَعَدَ قَدْرَ التَّشَهُدِ. When he has sat for the duration of saying the tashahud. فَإِنْ وَجَدَ الْمَاءَ قَبْلَ أَنْ يَقْعُدَ قَدْرَ التَّشَهُدِ. If he found water before he sat for the duration of the tashahud, then he is going to be required to redo the salah. Now, I'm not going to elaborate on these masail. My whole objective of going through this text is just to share with you how this book has been formatted. This is just a little glimpse, right, of this foundational work. This work is the prime work of the Hanafi Madhab. It's the foundational book. This along with the next book. So let's go to the next book, inshallah. So that's Kitab al-Asl right there. The next book is Jami' al-Saghir. Okay, Al-Jami' al-Saghir. Now this book, Al-Jami' al-Saghir, is a book that Imam Muhammad rahmatullahi alayhi prepared, in which he is reporting and recording the views of Abu Hanifa via Abu Yusuf. So everything that is in here is what he learned under Abu Yusuf rahmatullahi alayhi. Right? So let's give you an example. Right? Let's open this book up. It's a bit challenging because I'm holding the camera in my hand. And inshallah, once we do advance in these videos, we'll make them more professional going forward. But anyways, I just wanted to share this with you. Look at this. Okay? You look at this, Muhammad. That's himself. So he's saying Muhammad an Ya'qub. Ya'qub is Abu Yusuf rahmatullahi alayhi. His real name is Ya'qub ibn Ibrahim. So he's saying Muhammad himself is reporting from Ya'qub, who reported from Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi. And then he goes to start talking about the regulation of discussion. So this chapter is on Salatul Jumu'ah. Okay, a chapter on the prayer of Jumu'ah. And he's saying that fi imamin salla al-jumu'ata. So we're talking about an imam that's performed the Jumu'ah prayer. فَنَفَرَ النَّاسَ عَنْهُ. فَتَنَفَرَ النَّاسُ عَنْهُ. People have all run away from him. So you have an imam that began the Jumu'ah prayer and the entire congregation pretty much abandoned him, left him. قَبْلَ أَنْ يَرْقَعَ وَيَسْجُدَ. Before he went into ruku' and sujood. إِلَّا النِّسَاءَ وَالسِّبْيَانَ. With the exception of women and children. So all the men have left for some reason. Not sure exactly what issues they had with the imam that had risen during the salah, due to which they felt the obligation to leave him. But this is a scenario, a hypothetical scenario. Imam is performing the Jumu'ah prayer. The men from the congregation leave. Only the women and the children are left behind. What is going to be the status of this salah? So Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi is saying, istaqbala dhuhra. This imam is now going to he's going to now finish off the prayer. They're going to break the prayer and then start the prayer all over as the dhuhr prayer. But Imam Abu Yusuf and Muhammad, so there you see Imam Muhammad making reference to his own ustad and himself, that his viewpoint, it's not really coinciding with the viewpoint of Abu Hanifa, but he's saying Abu Yusuf and Muhammad say, إِذَا افْتَطَحَ الصَّلَىٰ, when he begins the prayer, ثُمَّ نَفَرَ النَّاسُ عَنْهُ صَلَّى الْجُمُعَىٰ. So if he's already begun the prayer and then the people all abandoned him, they ran away for some reason, he will continue with the Jumu'ah prayer and they continue to go on to discuss that regulation in a bit more detail. So again, I just wanted to share here how this book is formatted. So these two books, okay, when you see here, Al-Jami' al-Saghir and Al-Asl, these two books are your foundation of the Hanafi Madhhab. Okay, the whole entire madhab is structured on these. It's built on these two books. All right, so this is important for you to know. Now, there are other books which are very important. So you're going to have, for example, Al-Jami' al-Kabir. Okay, now this book Imam Muhammad rahmatullahi prepared, in which he only discusses a handful of ritualistic regulations, but the bulk is now on non-ritualistic issues, whether it's dealing with marriage, whether it's going to deal with finances, whether it's going to deal with business, right? There's a whole bunch of different regulations that he now basically goes into. And I just wanted to share this. So for example, you have this chapter here, Babun ma yaj'alu rajulu ما يجعل رجل أمر امرأته فيه إلى غيرها بالوقت. Okay, so this is in respect to a man that's putting the marriage affair of his wife into someone else's hands, but with a time frame. So now he's giving you a hypothetical scenario. So this is basically what this is about, where a person puts the fate of his marriage in another person's hands, who's now going to decide whether this marriage is going to continue or break. So that's what he says, Rajulun. So this is Imam Muhammad himself now, recording his masail. He says, Rajulun qala amru imraati biyadi fulanin shahran, that the affair of my wife is in the hands of so-and-so for a month. Fal amru biyadihi shahran mundhu qal. So now the matter is now going to be in that person's hands for an entire month from the point he had uttered these words. That's just to give you an example, okay, of one regulation. And now it's for that individual to decide whether they want to they want this marriage to continue or break it. Now, this is not something that we do in our society, but basically this is a tradition that needed to be addressed in his time, which he is doing. And that's another thing about fiqh. Fiqh is alive. It keeps on addressing the issues of the time. It does not stagnate. So this is another book that is very important in the Hanafi Madhab, Al-Jami' al-Kabir, as you can see it. Okay, so those are three books right there. And let's go to the fourth book. Now, this is not the original book. This is Sharh al-Ziyadat by Imam Qazi Khan. But the actual book, so this is a commentary. But the actual book is Az-Ziyadat. I don't have the original book. Inshallah, I'll try and obtain it in the future. But basically, the real book is Az-Ziyadat. And really what this book is all the regulations Imam Muhammad rahmatullahi alayhi left out from these three books, Asal, Jami' al-Saghir, and Jami' al-Kabir. He now basically put it inside this book. That's why it's called Ziyadat, which means additions. Okay, so it's basically now, this is an add-on, okay, this would be basically additional regulations that didn't make it in these three compilations. So this is the commentary on it that I have right now, and this is a very important book, right, putting that up here, inshallah. So now, these four books, along with two more, Siyar al-Saghir and Siyar al-Kabir. I don't have the copies of those books. But these four books, along with those two, which I don't have the copies of, are considered by latter-day scholars the Zahir al-Riwayat. Zahir al-Riwayat. It's basically a term that is used to make reference to the regulations that have been now extracted from these six books. Four here, two which I don't have. Siyar al-Kabir and Siyar al-Saghir, what are they about? They're more about the regulations of governance, military rules of engagement. So Siyar al-Saghir is more a concise book. Kabir is more of an elaborative book, but they both are on the same theme. Okay, so those six books, they are now going to be considered Zahir al-Riwayat. Whatever Masail are now going to be taken from here, they will take precedence over the Masail that Imam Muhammad rahmatullahi alayhi compiles in his other books. Okay, so this basically are the prime books of Imam Muhammad rahmatullahi alayhi as considered by latter-day scholars. Remember, it's important for us to understand that that term Zahir al-Riwayat was not something that Imam Muhammad had come up with. It's a term that latter-day scholars actually came up with, and that's a video that I'm going to do, inshallah, very soon. We're going to go over that how these books evolved into becoming the reference points of the Madhab. Now, another three books I wanted to quickly acquaint you with is Kitabul Athar. Now, this is a book Imam Muhammad rahmatullahi prepared, in which he is reporting the ahadith and the athar of his ustad Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi directly. So look at this, for example. You're going to see here 183, Muhammadun Qala. So he's always making reference to himself as the third person. Says Muhammadun Qala, Akhbarana Abu Hanifata an Hammadin an Ibrahim fi al-Rajuli yajlisu khalfa al-Imami qadra al-Tashahud thumma yansarifu qabla an yusallim al-Imam qala la yujzi'hi وقال عطاء بن أبي رباح إذا جلس قدر التشهد أجزاءه. Okay, قال أبو حنيفة قولي قول عطاء وقال محمد ويقول عطاء نأخذه نحن أيضا. Okay, so what he's basically now showing here is one fatwa of his Sheikh Ibrahim al-Nakhai, which is obviously the Sheikh of his Sheikh, Imam Hamad bin Abi Sulaiman. So what you're saying is Imam Muhammad is now reporting from Abu Hanifa, reports from his Ustad, Hamad bin Abi Sulaiman, who's reporting this fatwa of Ibrahim al-Nakhai about a man who's going to sit behind the Imam for the duration of the Tashahud, and then he's going to walk up, he's going to get up and walk away before the Imam even says salam. So is this prayer going to suffice? Ibrahim al-Nakhai is saying that that prayer is not going to suffice that follower of the Imam. Atta bin Abi Rabah is saying that if that person did sit for the duration of the Tashahud and then he got up and went away before the Imam says salam, ajza'ahu, it's going to be sufficient for him. And Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi is saying that his viewpoint coincides with Atta ibn Abi Rabah. So you have two fatwas from two different tabi'un. One is from Ibrahim al-Nakhai and another is I should say Tabi'u al-Tabi'i, and one is basically Atta ibn Abi Rabah, and Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi is choosing Atta ibn Abi Rabah's fatwa over Ibrahim al-Nakhai's fatwa. Imam Muhammad rahmatullahi also says that we're going to follow the fatwa of Atta ibn Abi Rabah. And then you see in the next one, Sami'tu Umar ibn Khattab. So there, Imam Muhammad rahmatullahi alayhi is going to cite a hadith, okay, which is doesn't include Abu Hanifa, but going to Shu'bah bin Hajjaj to Abu Nadhr, was saying that he heard from Hamala bin Abdul Rahman, saying that he heard Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu saying, La salata illa bi tashahudin, that there's no prayer except with tashahud. So this basically is a book in which Imam Muhammad rahmatullahi alayhi is going to record the ahadith and the athar and the fatawa that have come through Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi primarily, and then from other sources as well, as you saw with Shu'bah. But the bulk of this book is really on whatever he has obtained through Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayh. Now, there is an English translation of this book available in the market. I would highly recommend that you get a copy for yourself and go through it. It's very beneficial. Now, the next book is the Mu'atta. Now, this is the Mu'atta of Imam Malik as per the copy of Muhammad bin Hassan al-Shaybani rahmatullahi alayh. Okay, so what you have here is Imam Muhammad rahmatullahi alayh he's recorded the narrations of Imam Malik, but then he basically has gone ahead and supplemented the narrations with his own viewpoints, his own fatawa. So in Muwatta Imam Malik, Imam Malik rahmatullahi alayhi, what he does is he's going to share his narrations, and then after he's going to share the regulations which are now being deduced or that are now connected to those narrations, right? So Imam Muhammad rahmatullahi, what he has done, he's taken those narrations of Imam Malik, but then he's put his own regulations under those narrations. And here's an example, right, of a person that's now going to recite different surahs in a raka'ah of a farad prayer. So he's saying, look, akhbarana Malik. Okay, Imam Malik reported to us from Nafi, akhbarana Nafi'un an ibn Umar, annahu kana idha salla wahdahu yaqra'u fil arba'i jami'a. That when Ibn Umar radiallahu anhu would perform the prayer on his own, he would recite in every one of the four raka'at of Dhuhr and Asr, and fi kulli raka'atin bi fatihatil Qur'an wa suratin min al-Qur'an. In each of those four raka'at, he would be reciting Surah Al-Fatiha and a surah from the Qur'an. Wa kana ahyanan yaqra'u bi suratayn. Sometimes he would recite two surahs, sometimes three, in a farad prayer. Okay? في الركعة الواحدة ويقرأ في الركعتين الأوليين من المغرب كذلك بأم القرآن وسورة سورة. Okay, and then he also goes ahead to say that what he would do in the first two rakat of Maghrib, again he would recite with the Surah Al-Fatiha along with the Surah and another Surah if he wished to. Now that's a narration Imam Malik rahmatullah is reporting. This is an athar. It's not a hadith, it's an athar because it's about a sahabi. And then Imam Muhammad rahmatullah alayhi is now sharing his viewpoint. As-sunnatu an yuqra'a fil faridati fil raka'atin al-ulayni bifatihati al-kitab wa suratin wa fil ukhrayni bifatihati al-kitab. So this is a regulation from Imam Muhammad. Typically in the Muwatta Imam Malik, and Imam Malik would now supplement this with his own regulations, which Imam Muhammad is not included in his version. Okay, so he said the sunnah is that recitation be done in the first two rakat of every farad prayer with the Fatihatul Kitab, Suratul Fatiha, and a surah. And in the final two rakat, just with Suratul Fatiha. And if he doesn't recite anything in those final two rakat, then that will suffice him. Ajza'aka. Wa in sabbahta, if you go ahead and just say Subhanallah in those final two rakat, that will also be sufficient. It will suffice you. And that is the view of Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi. So this is just to give you a brief orientation on how he prepared the Muwatta of Imam Malik in his own version, right? And the final book that I wanted to share with you is this book, Kitab al-Hujja ala Ahl al-Madina. Those of us who are following me on Facebook, you see that this is the very book that I'm basically teaching every Wednesday nights. And what is the style here? Well, the style is very straightforward. What you're going to have, for example, is Imam Muhammad rahmatullahi quoting Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi on an issue. Then he's going to go ahead and quote the Madani scholars' viewpoint on that same issue. And then he's now going to weigh in the discussion and basically tell you whether the Medina scholars are right or Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi is right. He basically now will weigh in and give you his conclusions. So this pretty much is another book that Imam Muhammad rahmatullahi prepared along with many other books. Okay, so Kitab al-Hujja ala Ahl Medina, the argument against the scholars of Medina. Okay, so these books that you're seeing here are the books that founded the Hanafi Madhab. The prime books are these four, along with the two that I mentioned, and then these will be supplementary texts, okay, that you see here. Okay, these are supplementary texts, and there's much more, but this is just what I have in my collection, which I wanted to share with you, inshallah. Hopefully this has been of benefit. So there you have it. That was just a brief orientation on the books of Imam Muhammad bin Hassan al-Shaybani rahimahullah. These were the contributions that he had made for the Hanafi Madhab as we know it today. Hopefully this has been of benefit, inshallah. In the next video, I'm going to show you and I'm going to demonstrate how these books were taken by scholars of the next generation from other regions and how it was used now to form the madhab as we know it today. Hopefully, inshallah, today's lesson has been of great benefit to you. I'd really like to hear your comments, inshallah, your feedback on these videos. If there's something that we can do, inshallah, to improve the experience, or there's something that you felt that needs to be elaborated on, let us know in the comments, inshallah, and we will be more than happy to address them. Until next time, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.